Thank you, Pierre. It's my pleasure to welcome and introduce our first presenter, Dr. Robert Puckrin. He's a hematologist and clinical investigator at the Tom Baker Cancer Center in Calgary and also at the University of Calgary. He obtained his medical degree from McGill University and completed internal medicine training at the University of Toronto and further training at the University of Calgary. His main research interests are lymphoma, blood cell transplants, CAR T cells, and immune therapies. Following Dr. Puckrin's presentation, there will be a question and answer period. A number of questions have been submitted in advance. You can add questions during the presentation by typing them in the chat. Dr. Puckrin.
All right. Good morning, everybody. Thanks so much for having me here today. Pleasure to be with you. So I have the pleasure of giving an update today on a general introduction and overview of Waldenstrom's macroglobulinemia, as well as explanation of what tests are often done, especially at diagnosis, and how to understand and interpret your test results as well. I apologize if my voice is a little bit scratchy. I'm recovering from a minor cold this week, but hopefully you can all hear me okay. So next slide, please. So we'll start with the quick introduction as to what Waldenstrom's macroglobulinemia is. So this is a lymphoma, which is a type of blood cancer affecting the lymphatics or immune system. It's an indolent lymphoma, which means that it's slow growing. It typically develops over a period of many months to many years. It usually has a very good long-term prognosis, and oftentimes it can go for many years without requiring any treatment. And that's different from more aggressive lymphomas, which tend to grow more quickly over a period of weeks to months and can be quite dangerous if not treated properly and quickly. Another term that you might hear for Waldenstrom's is lymphoplasmacytic lymphoma, or LPL. They're often used interchangeably, but there is a slight difference between the two. So Waldenstrom's is actually the most common subtype of lymphoplasmacytic lymphoma. And what makes Waldenstrom special is that the lymphoma overproduces a very large amount of a specific antibody, and that's called an immunoglobulin M protein. So there are different kinds of antibodies in our immune system. They're all important for helping fight off infection. Some of them are IgA or IgG antibodies, but in Waldenstrom's, it's the IgM that gets overproduced. And you can see on the right here a picture of what an IgM antibody looks like. It's got five different arms. And what makes it unique is that it's quite a large antibody. It takes up a lot of space in the blood, and it can also affect the immune system in different ways, which we'll talk about soon. There are other types of lymphoplasmacytic lymphomas that don't produce an IgM. So technically, they're not considered Waldenstrom's because they don't have the IgM protein. But in those cases, they can produce other antibodies like IgA or IgG, or sometimes they don't produce any antibodies at all. But they're still quite similar to Waldenstrom's, and we still tend to treat them in a similar way as well. Next slide. So this slide gives an overview of the actual biology of Waldenstrom's. This is a cancer that develops in the B cells, which are an important part of our lymphocytes and a major player in our immune system. On the left, you can see that B cells typically start off in the bone marrow where they're produced, and then they can travel through the blood and eventually the lymph nodes where they undergo a maturation process. Eventually, B cells mature into the most advanced form of a B cell, which is called a plasma cell. You can see that on the bottom left. And normal, healthy plasma cells are the cells that are responsible for making all of the IgA, IgG, and IgM antibodies that our immune system needs. But sometimes mutations can occur in this pathway, and instead of turning into a normal, healthy plasma cell, these mature B cells can instead turn into a lymphoplasmacytic cell, which is the cancerous cell that's involved in Waldenstrom's. And you can see here a picture on the right of what these cells actually look like under the microscope. The large purple cells are the lymphoplasmacytic cells. And when you look at them under the microscope, they share similar features between both a B lymphocyte and a plasma cell. So that's where the name comes from, lymphoplasmacytic. It shares features of both types of cells. Next slide, please. So where did this name, Waldenstrom's macroglobulinemia, come from? So this disease was first described back in the 1940s by a Swedish physician by the name of Jan Waldenstrom. And he reported two patients who had a rare but similar condition. Both patients experienced bleeding as well as anemia or low red blood cells. And they had a lot of lymphoma filling up the bone marrow, as well as a very high amount of a large protein in the blood. And at that time, the word for this was macroglobulin, hence the name Waldenstrom's macroglobulinemia. And the name still has stuck, and we still use it many decades later. Next slide, please. So who's at risk of developing Waldenstrom's? It is a very rare blood cancer. It tends to only affect 3 to 6 of every million people. Probably the most important risk factor is older age. So it does tend to occur in people over the age of 60 to 70, but it can occur at younger or older ages as well. It tends to be slightly more common in men compared to women, and slightly more common in Caucasians compared to other ethnicities. There are some other risk factors as well. So if someone has a family history of Waldenstrom's, they may also have a slightly increased risk of the disease, although overall the risk still is quite low because of how rare the cancer is to begin with. Certain autoimmune conditions, like rheumatoid arthritis, for example, can sometimes predispose to Waldenstrom's, as can certain infections, like chronic hepatitis infections, for example. And then there's a condition called monoclonal gammopathy of undetermined significance, or MGUS, or MUGUS. And this is sort of a precursor or a precancerous condition. Sometimes we can detect an abnormal IgM protein in the blood. And if it's at a small level and it's not causing the body any problems, we term that MGUS. And it's not so much a cancer itself, but it sometimes can evolve into a cancer, sometimes over a period of many, many years. And it can evolve into Waldenstrom's in some cases. Next slide, please. So why does Waldenstrom's cause problems? So there are different ways it can do so. One of the most common is that the bone marrow, which is the factory of our blood, deep inside our bones, really becomes filled up with these lymphoma cells. And you can see on the right a picture of the bone marrow where lymphoma cells have basically replaced the bone marrow, and there's no space for the normal bone marrow stem cells to grow and make fresh blood. So as a result of all this crowding, the normal healthy blood counts can start to drop. So patients often become anemic when they don't have enough red blood cells to carry oxygen around the body. They can sometimes become thrombocytopenic, which is a term that refers to low platelet levels, and that can increase the risk of bleeding or bruising because platelets are important for making blood clots. In some cases, patients can be leukopenic, which means they have low white blood cells, although in some cases, the white blood cells can actually be a little bit elevated, especially if there are lymphoma cells in the bloodstream. And then Waldenstrom's usually affects the bone marrow, but sometimes it can affect other parts of the lymphatic system as well. So sometimes it can cause enlarged lymph nodes or an enlarged spleen, although most patients tend not to have that or only have mild enlargements. I mentioned that Waldenstrom's also produces very large amounts of this IgM antibody on the bottom right there. And because this antibody is so large, it can thicken the blood and cause what's called hyperviscosity. So this is a syndrome that's caused by blood thickening, and it basically causes poor blood flow to different parts of the body. So often it will affect the very small vessels in the eyes, for example, and cause blurry vision, or it can affect the small blood vessels in the nose or mouth and cause bleeding, or in the head, it can cause symptoms like headache or confusion or ringing of the ears, for example. The IgM protein can also affect the immune system and body in other ways. So it is an antibody, and it can cause some immune effects, often autoimmune effects. So in some cases, the IgM antibody can attack the nerves and cause neuropathy. So that often causes numbness, tingling, loss of sensation, or weakness in the arms or legs. The antibody can also attack the normal healthy red blood cells and cause hemolysis, which is a term that refers to red blood cell breakdown. then sometimes the antibodies can get deposited in different tissues of the body, like the heart or the kidneys or the skin, and that can interfere with the function of those organs, and that's called amyloidosis. And we'll touch on those a little bit in more detail later. Next slide, please. So what are the symptoms of Waldenstrom's? You know, it can be very tricky because some patients don't have any symptoms at all, or they can have very variable symptoms because Waldenstrom's can affect the body in so many different ways. But the most common symptom is fatigue, and that's usually due to anemia or low red blood cells. But some patients may have other symptoms as well. Sometimes the lymphoma can release inflammatory proteins into the body that can cause B symptoms. So that refers to fevers or drenching night sweats or unintentional weight loss. Because of some of the other complications that Waldenstrom's can cause, there can be tendencies to have increased bleeding or bruising. Some patients may notice enlarged or swollen lymph nodes or a large spleen that can cause some pressure in the abdomen or make it hard to eat a full meal, for example. I mentioned that some can get hyperviscosity or thickened blood with blurry vision, easy bleeding, or headaches. And then neuropathy is also a fairly common symptom with numbness, tingling, or weakness in the arms or legs. Next slide, please. So how do we actually make the diagnosis? So the diagnosis is actually based on a combination of things. You know, a patient's symptoms are very important, as well as the results of their blood tests. But ultimately, we do need a biopsy as well to confirm what type of lymphoma we're doing or dealing with. And the most common biopsy that we perform in Waldenstrom's is a bone marrow biopsy. So you can see a picture of how that works on the left here. It's an outpatient procedure, meaning that we do it in clinic. It's not done in an operating room. There's no general anesthesia required. It takes usually about 10 to 15 minutes, and a person has to lie on their side. We clean the skin to help prevent infection, and then we also put lots of local anesthetic or freezing in to help minimize any discomfort. And then using a couple of very small needles, like you can see here in the picture, we can take some fluid from the bone marrow from the backside, as well as a small biopsy of the bone marrow. And then our pathologist can then look at that sample under the microscope, like you see on the right here, and perform special staining and other tests that will confirm that this is Waldenstrom's macroglobulinemia or lymphoplasmacytic lymphoma. Next slide, please. There are a number of other important tests that we also do at diagnosis. So the most important one to know about is the serum protein electrophoresis, or SPEP. And you can see a picture on the right of how that works. This is basically a test where we collect a sample of blood, and then we put it on a gel where the proteins in the blood are then separated. And you can see these different spikes on the right that refer to different kinds of protein. On the left, you see albumin, which is a normal healthy protein that we all have. But on the far right, there's an extra spike, which normally isn't found in the blood. But in the case of Waldenstrom's, which overproduces a very large antibody, there's this extra spike that appears. So that spike has different terms. Some people call it an M spike. Some people call it an M protein. Another word is monoclonal protein. So that basically means that the body has too much of a particular protein. And we can do additional testing to confirm exactly what type of protein it is. In Waldenstrom's, it's an IgM protein. And this test can also help to measure or quantify how much protein there is in the body. The amount of IgM can vary quite a lot between patients. You know, some patients maybe have a very small level of maybe only 5 or 10 grams of the protein per liter of blood. Some people can have a very high level above 60 or 70 grams per liter of blood. And the symptoms can vary quite a bit. The higher the protein is, the more likely there may be to develop a risk of hyperviscosity. But some people with very high protein levels don't have any symptoms, whereas some people with very low protein levels may have symptoms because of other complications like neuropathy, for example. So the exact number may not matter so much. It's probably the symptoms that are more important. But the test is crucial to confirming the type of protein as well as to measuring and monitoring it over time. So that's the SPEP. It's the most critical test. There are other tests that we also perform that can help to measure our antibody levels in different ways. So there's another test which is called a quantitative immunoglobulin measurement. And this is a test that will measure the levels of all our common antibodies, including IgA, IgG, and IgM. This test is important to perform because it gets reported a bit more quickly than the SPEP, so we often get the results sooner. But in Waldenstrom's and other similar blood cancers, when the immune system is making too much of an IgM antibody, the resources of our immune system kind of all go into making that IgM antibody. And as a result, the levels of the other normal healthy antibodies like IgA or IgG can go down. So some people with Waldenstrom's can have a very high IgM, but a very low IgA or IgG. And having low levels of IgA or IgG may increase the risk of infections. So it's something that we often monitor. And if people are prone to recurrent or severe infections, we can sometimes give replacement antibody levels to help compensate for the ones that a patient may not be making on their own. There are some other tests that can also be done to measure antibody levels in different ways. So a more recent test is called the serum free light chain assay. I won't go into too much detail because it's not always performed and it's not as helpful in Waldenstrom's as it is in some other blood cancers like myeloma. But basically every antibody contains two heavy chains like IgG, IgM, or IgA, as well as two light chains like kappa or lambda. And this serum-free light chain test can measure those light chains that don't get measured with the other standard tests. It tends not to affect the diagnosis or prognosis of Waldenstrom's quite as much, but it can be helpful in certain situations. For example, if there are any signs of kidney dysfunction or amyloid where the proteins get deposited in the skin, then measuring the light chains can be helpful to determine the cause of those symptoms. Another way to measure them is to do a 24-hour urine collection, where we can measure all the proteins that are excreted through the kidneys into the urine. And that can also be helpful to measure the light chains and to check for any abnormal proteins and to assess how well the kidneys are working as well. Next slide, please. Sometimes we also do genetic testing in Waldenstrom's, and that can often be done on the bone marrow biopsy that was performed at diagnosis. The most important gene to know about is this MYD88 gene. And this is a gene that's very important to helping B cells grow and proliferate and survive. And most cases of Waldenstrom's, more than 90%, do have a particular mutation in this gene that can predispose to the cancer. And we can oftentimes test for this gene. And if we find this mutation, that can help confirm the diagnosis. There are some other genes that can become mutated as well, like CXCR4 or the TP53 gene. It can be helpful to know because having these mutations can affect how well a person might respond to specific treatments. But these tests are not widely available in Canada, so we tend not to do them very frequently. But sometimes they are done as part of clinical trials, for example. But the MYD88 gene mutation test can be done in many parts of Canada. Next slide, please. Now, we also sometimes perform imaging tests at diagnosis. On the right, you can see a picture of a CT scan, which is like a very detailed whole body X-ray. And this is often done at diagnosis to help assess for any enlarged lymph nodes, enlarged liver, or enlarged spleen, which can occur in Waldenstrom's, although it's fairly uncommon. So like I mentioned, most people tend to have either no enlarged lymph nodes or perhaps only small ones. But a CT can be helpful at diagnosis just to check for that. PET scans are a more sophisticated version of a CT scan where a special contrast or dye is given. It's basically a kind of radioactive sugar that gets taken up by lymphoma or other inflammatory processes, and the lymphoma can light up on the PET scan. The problem with Waldenstrom's is that it's a very indolent or slow-growing cancer, so it tends not to take up a lot of that sugar dye, and it tends not to be very bright on a PET scan. So as a result, PET scans aren't usually as helpful in Waldenstrom's. We tend not to do them very frequently. They can be more helpful in other more aggressive lymphomas. And Waldenstrom's has a small risk that at some point in the disease course, it can transform to a more aggressive disease. And if there's a suspicion for that, based on a rapidly enlarging lymph node, for example, then a PET scan can be helpful to confirm. But otherwise, for most patients, a CT is the most standard imaging test for Waldenstrom's. Sometimes, rarely, Waldenstrom's can also affect the brain and the nervous system. It's a complication called Bing-Neel syndrome. So if a person has unexplained neurologic symptoms like headaches or confusion, for example, then doing an MRI of the brain can be helpful. And we may also consider doing a lumbar puncture, which is a small biopsy where a little bit of the fluid from around the spinal cord can be removed and tested for lymphoma. Next slide, please. Now, what other tests are also important to diagnosis? So there are a number of blood tests that we measure. The most important one is the complete blood count, or the CBC. And this measures levels of red blood cells, platelets, and white blood cells. So we do this because it's important to check for low red blood cells anemia, low platelets thrombocytopenia, or low white blood cells leukopenia, which all can occur if the bone marrow is filled up with lymphoma. It's also important to measure how well the body's organs are functioning. So creatinine is a blood test that measures our kidney function, and then we can also measure liver function tests to assess its function. And then there are a few other special blood tests that are useful for determining prognosis. So lactate dehydrogenase, LDH, beta-2 microglobulin, and albumin, they're kind of tumor markers, and the LDH and beta-2 microglobulin can go up quite a bit if there's a high burden of lymphoma in the body. And at diagnosis, we also commonly check or screen for certain infections. Some viruses like hepatitis C can predispose to lymphoma. Others like hepatitis B can sometimes live quiet or dormant in our body for many, many years, but can reactivate if we become immune compromised from chemotherapy, for example. So if a person has been exposed to hepatitis B in the past, we often have to give them an antiviral medicine to help prevent the medicine or the virus from reactivating after starting chemotherapy. Next slide, please. So why are all these tests important? Well, I mentioned the bone marrow biopsy and the genetic testing is helpful to confirm the diagnosis. But many of the other tests are really important for helping determine whether or not we need to treat the lymphoma now, or if a person has no symptoms and is feeling entirely well, they can often be monitored and go without treatment for some time, oftentimes many years. So you can see here a list of some of the common reasons for starting treatment in Waldenstrom's. So at the top, you can see a number of symptoms that do indicate a need to start treatment. These can be things like fevers, night sweats, weight loss, fatigue, hyperviscosity or thickened blood, very large or bothersome lymph nodes or spleen, or having neuropathy from Waldenstrom's. And then on the bottom, you can see some of the laboratory-based reasons for starting treatment. So commonly, that's if there is anemia with the hemoglobin less than 100 grams per liter or 10 grams per deciliter in American units, or a platelet count that goes below 100. So all those tests that I mentioned, as well as the kidney and liver function, if they're affected by the lymphoma, can all give us an indication of whether or not the disease needs to be treated or whether it can be safely monitored. Next slide, please. The tests are also very helpful for prognostication and for help determining the need for future treatment, as well as the overall prognosis. So on the left here, you can see the AWM patient risk calculator. You can find this online. And this is really designed for people who have Waldenstrom's, but right now they don't have any symptoms, they're feeling completely well, and they don't require any treatment at this time. So by plugging in these values, the first one is, you know, how much lymphoma is there in the bone marrow? The second is, what is the IgM antibody level in the blood? The third, what is the beta-2 microglobulin, one of those tumor markers? And the fourth, what is albumin? That's a normal healthy protein. And if you put those in, this calculator can kind of give an estimate of how many years you might expect to be able to go without requiring treatment. So some people with very low risk Waldenstrom's might be able to go on average for 9 or 10 years without requiring treatment, whereas someone who perhaps has more advanced Waldenstrom's may need treatment in the next year or two. So these tests can help give us a sense of what to expect. On the right is the International Prognostic Scoring System. So this is a tool that we can use at the time of starting treatment for people who do need treatment for the disease. And this includes age, as well as hemoglobin, platelet count, beta-2 microglobulin, and the IgM antibody level in the blood. And by adding these points together, we can get a general estimate of life expectancy or survival after treatment. We do have to keep in mind, though, that the pace of treatment and innovation is increasing very quickly in many blood cancers, including Waldenstrom. So some of the prognostic scores and survival estimates that were developed in the past are no longer as applicable thanks to all the different new treatments we have for the disease. People are living better and longer than ever before. Next slide, please. So what other testing may be useful? I mentioned hyperviscosity, which is thickening of the blood. And that's not so much a common complication, but is an important one to look out for. So there is a test that's called the serum viscosity test, where we can actually measure how thick the blood has become because of the abnormal IgM protein. So normal water has a viscosity of 1 centipoise, or CP. Our blood normally has a viscosity of around 1.8 or less, but in Waldenstrom's, if the IgM level goes particularly high, you know, above 40 to 60 grams per liter, then the viscosity can rise to as high as 4 to 6 or beyond, and that can sometimes lead to symptoms. So most commonly, it can affect the eyes and cause blurry vision. So it's important to see an eye doctor in that situation to have a proper retinal exam, which you can see here on the right. And sometimes there can be traces of small bleeding or swelling in the retina because the small blood vessels are very fragile and can't withstand the high pressure from the thickened blood. Next slide, please. There are a number of other specialized tests that can also be done to help assess for some of the more rare complications of Waldenstrom's. Because these are very rare, they tend not to be done very frequently, but probably the most important one to know about would be tests that we can do for neuropathy. So that's when Waldenstrom's, the antibody affects the nerve function. So we can often refer patients to a neurologist who can perform electromyogram or nerve conduction studies that you can see on the right. And that will actually help to measure the nerve function and to document which nerves are affected. And it can also confirm that most likely the nerve damage is due to Waldenstrom's versus some other cause. And there are also specific blood tests where we can measure antibodies that are targeted against the nerve and being produced by the lymphoma. They aren't 100% helpful, but in some cases they can confirm that the neuropathy is related to the lymphoma. There are a few other less common complications as well. So sometimes the IgM antibody can target the red blood cells and cause hemolysis or red blood cell breakdown. And sometimes that can be triggered by an antibody that really only works in cold temperatures. So some people can be prone to red blood cell breakdown when the temperature drops and the blood in their fingers or their toes becomes quite cold. So there's a specific test called cold agglutinin testing, which can screen for that. Sometimes the IgM proteins can also cause a complication called cryoglobulins. So this is when the abnormal proteins kind of form clumps in the blood and can get deposited in the small blood vessels, and it can cause rashes or Raynaud's phenomenon. Next slide, please. So this is an example of Raynaud's, where the blood flow to the fingers is impaired by these clumped proteins, and the fingers can then change colors. They can go from red to white to blue and become very uncomfortable. Lots of other things can cause Raynaud's, so it's not usually due to Waldenstrom's, but if a person with Waldenstrom's starts to develop Raynaud's or other similar rashes, then it can be a good idea to check for these cryoglobulin proteins. Some patients can also be prone to increased bleeding or bruising, perhaps because their platelets are low, but sometimes the IgM protein can interfere with our clotting factors, which are important for helping form blood clots. One of the more common clotting factors is called von Willebrand's factor. So if a patient does have unusual or unexplained bruising or bleeding, we can actually measure these clotting factors, including von Willebrand's, to see if they're affected by the lymphoma. And then rarely, Waldenstrom's can cause amyloidosis, where the abnormal proteins get deposited in the different organs of the body. That's commonly the kidneys or the nerves or the heart. And the only way to make that diagnosis for sure is to actually do a biopsy. So sometimes we can find the amyloid proteins in the bone marrow. Sometimes we can do a biopsy of the skin and find them there. Or in some cases, we may actually have to biopsy the affected organ, like the kidney, for example, to confirm that's what's going on. Next slide, please. So what about after treatment and during long-term follow-up? What are the important tests to do then? So the complete blood count or the CBC are very important during and after treatment. You know, lots of the treatments that we give for Waldenstrom's, like chemotherapy, for example, can affect the bone marrow function and cause low blood counts. So we want to monitor them before each dose of treatment to make sure that we're not causing any excessive side effects and make sure the dosing of the treatment is correct. And the complete blood count also helps us know how well the treatment is working. You know, if a person is very anemic from Waldenstrom's, then we want to make sure that the hemoglobin or the red cells are improving with treatment as we clear the bone marrow of the lymphoma. It's also important to monitor the serum protein electrophoresis to see how the IgM antibody level is changing over time. Usually, when we treat the lymphoma, the IgM antibody level will gradually fall down to a low level. But it's important to remember that some treatments, for example, rituximab, which is an antibody that's really targeted to the lymphoma, it can actually cause a temporary surge in IgM. So after we give the dose, it can cause the lymphoma cells to die off quickly, and they can release a lot of IgM into the bloodstream. So it can temporarily go up and then start to go down afterwards. So if a person has a very high IgM level at baseline, more than 40 grams per liter, for example, we often will actually not give rituximab with the first dose of chemo, just to prevent side effects that can occur from that surge of the IgM protein. But once the IgM starts to come down, thanks to the chemotherapy, we can then reintroduce the rituximab later on once it's safe. At the end of treatment, we may sometimes consider repeating a CT scan. That can be helpful, especially for the minority of patients who have enlarged lymph nodes or an enlarged spleen at baseline. And repeating the scan at the end of treatment can help determine how well those lymph nodes have shrunken, and it can also help serve as a new baseline for monitoring going forward. And then a bone marrow biopsy at the end of treatment probably isn't necessary for all patients. Usually we get a good sense of how well the treatment is working based on the blood counts and the serum protein electrophoresis. But sometimes the bone marrow biopsy can be helpful. For example, if a patient is being treated on a clinical trial, we'll often do a bone marrow biopsy at the end of treatment to help have a more accurate sense of how well the treatment worked. Or if there are cases where we're not so sure how well the disease responded, or if the blood counts are still low for unexplained reasons, then we may consider a bone marrow biopsy afterwards to help determine what's going on in the bone marrow. Next slide, please. This is a grid that shows how we actually assess how well the treatment is working, or the response to treatment. So you can see different categories here. A complete response is sort of the deepest response possible, which means that there's no more detectable IgM protein in the blood and no signs of the lymphoma in the bone marrow. A very good partial response means that the IgM protein has fallen by more than 90% with treatment. A partial response means that the IgM has fallen by more than 50%. A minor response means that the IgM has fallen by more than 25%. Stable disease means the IgM protein hasn't fallen by very much, maybe less than 25%. And progressive disease means that the lymphoma may be starting to grow again, and the IgM levels are starting to increase by 25% or more, or there are new symptoms. So this is a response assessment criteria that you may read about in clinical trials, for example. You know, in clinical practice, though, and you know, every day in the clinic, it may not be quite as helpful. The IgM, it's not a perfect marker of how well the disease is responding to treatment. Like I mentioned, sometimes it can go up very early because of rituximab, and sometimes it can go down, but even go down in a very delayed manner well after treatment is done. And sometimes it may not change very much, but the person's symptoms or blood counts or anemia may have improved significantly. So I think the most important measure of how well the treatment is working is really whether or not the person's symptoms are improving, whether their organ function is improving, and whether their blood counts have improved with treatment. And oftentimes we do see a significant response in those factors, even without seeing a complete reduction in the IgM, for example. Next slide, please. So once treatment is done, what monitoring do we do afterwards? And it can vary from person to person, but oftentimes we'll check in with the patient every 3 to 6 months for the first few years. We always check for any new symptoms of Waldenstrom's, fatigue, enlarged lymph nodes, bleeding, bruising, and neuropathy. A physical examination is often done to check for enlarged lymph nodes or an enlarged spleen. And then the most important blood test to monitor over time would be the complete blood count. And we want to keep an eye on how the bone marrow is recovering from treatment, as well as the serum protein electrophoresis, which can monitor the IgM protein levels over time. Usually the IgM levels will go down with treatment, but eventually they do start to gradually increase as the lymphoma becomes active again. But like I mentioned, it's not so much the IgM level that's important. We don't treat this disease based on the IgM level itself. We only treat the disease when it's causing problems to the body. So if there are symptoms that emerge over time, or if the blood counts start to become low again, that will determine when it's time to treat the disease again, rather than the IgM level itself. We usually don't have to do screening or surveillance CT scans or bone marrow biopsies for people who are being monitored after completing treatment. For the most part, we can monitor this disease quite easily with blood work and checking for symptoms. And people who are feeling well, they don't require any of these more advanced tests. But if there's a new symptom that comes up or an unexplained change in blood count, sometimes the scans or bone marrow biopsies can be helpful at that time. Next slide, please. So in conclusion, Waldenstrom's is a rare B-cell lymphoma, which overproduces a very large IgM protein. Some affected individuals may be completely free of symptoms, but some may have fatigue, low blood counts, less commonly enlarged lymph nodes or spleen, hyperviscosity or thickening of the blood, or various other neurologic or immune complications from the antibody. To make the diagnosis, the most important test would be the bone marrow biopsy and the blood tests, but CT imaging can also be helpful at baseline. And for monitoring the disease's activity during and after treatment, the most important blood tests would be the complete blood count to see what the red cells, platelets, and white blood cells are doing, as well as the serum protein electrophoresis, or SPEP, to monitor the IgM level over time. And I think that brings an end to my presentation. So thanks very much for your attention, and I'd be happy to take any questions.
Well, thank you, Dr. Puckrin. We have about 20 minutes for questions, and a number have been submitted in advance of the presentation, and some are being submitted as we talk. So they're coming in the chat group. So the first question we have, Dr. Puckrin, is on blood test results, what are the key markers that a Waldenstrom's patient should monitor closely, and what do they mean in simple terms?
Yeah, so probably the two most important ones would be the complete blood count or the CBC. Waldenstrom's or its treatment often can cause low blood counts, like low hemoglobin or low platelets most commonly. So that's probably the most important thing to keep an eye on. The other one is the serum protein electrophoresis, or SPEP, and that's the test that actually measures the IgM level that the lymphoma produces. And by measuring that level, we can get a sense of how active the disease is and what the trajectory is as well. Is it going up or is it slowly going down over time?
Okay, somewhat related, the next question is, what is the difference between the IgM and the M spike test? Which
So
one is more important to monitor?
it
Sorry, go
becomes a
ahead.
bit Yeah, it can become a bit tricky to distinguish all these different tests that we have to measure the antibody levels. The M spike or the M protein test is probably the most important. So that's the result that we get back from the serum protein electrophoresis or the SPEP. So that really helps to measure the abnormal IgM protein that's being produced by the lymphoma. We have another test that I alluded to. It's called the immunoglobulin quantification test. And that can measure the total levels of all the antibodies in our body, IgM, IgG, and IgA. That one is often done because it gets resulted a bit more quickly, but it doesn't necessarily tell us how much of the IgM in our body is normal, healthy IgM versus how much of it is the abnormal IgM being produced by the lymphoma. So that's why the SPEP is a bit more helpful. But we do often do them both to get a sort of complete sense of how things are looking.
Thank you. Can you please explain free light chains? Why I am sometimes tested for the kappa to lambda ratio? What does this have to do with my WM and its progression?
Good question. So every antibody has two heavy chains, IgA, IgG, or IgM, as well as two light chains, kappa or lambda. So in Waldenstrom's, we typically measure the heavy chain, which is the IgM, but you can also measure the light chain that goes along with it. So this is the newer test called the serum free light chain test, which measures the kappa or the lambda. Truthfully, it's not as helpful in Waldenstrom's as it is in some other blood cancers, like multiple myeloma, for example. Measuring light chains can be very helpful. But in Waldenstrom's, it doesn't quite have as much use. We may do it at baseline just to get a sense of how it looks, but it probably doesn't have to be monitored so frequently in most patients. It can be helpful in some specific situations. For example, if a person has kidney problems related to their Waldenstrom's or amyloidosis with the abnormal proteins that get deposited in different organs. In those cases, measuring the light chains can be a helpful clue as to the cause of those problems.
The next question has three parts. How does a serum viscosity blood test work? What is its reliability as a diagnostic? Are there other tests that can be used to test for hyperviscosity?
That's a great question. The serum viscosity test is a measurement of how thick the blood is, and they do it by comparing the thickness of a patient's blood to water. I gave some of those reference values earlier. Water normally has a standard thickness of one, it's been designated. Blood is normally less than 1.8. And if the serum viscosity goes above 4 to 6, that's when symptoms can occur. But truthfully, it's not a perfect marker of serum viscosity. Some people can have very high numbers and feel completely symptom-free. So probably the more useful indicator is how well is the patient feeling. If they have any symptoms of hyperviscosity, like blurry vision, headaches, easy bleeding or bruising, for example, that's the more important indicator of hyperviscosity. And in those cases, we often give a treatment called plasma exchange, where we remove the blood of the person to get rid of all of that high levels of antibodies and then replace it with normal healthy blood to help reduce the viscosity quickly.
Okay, thank you. Is WM a hereditary condition? If yes, when should I have my children screened?
So having a person in the family who has Waldenstrom's can increase the risk in other members of the family. Sometimes there can be shared genes that predispose to this lymphoma or other blood cancers that can be shared in the family. But it's not necessarily a lymphoma that's directly transmitted from generation to generation. Most people in the family are still not going to get the lymphoma. The risk of getting it is still quite low overall. So because of that, it's generally not recommended that people who are completely symptom-free be screened for Waldenstrom's if they have an affected family member. If a person has symptoms, then I think it would be appropriate to screen them. But because the risk is so low, people who are completely feeling well do not generally need to be screened.
Next question. coming from the chat, if I can scroll it up here, excuse me. Question has to do with why wait and watch if the tests show, even if you're not symptomatic, that you have Waldenstrom's, why not start treatment?
So that's a great question. Waldenstrom's, it's an indolent lymphoma, which means that it's a very slow growing disease. And oftentimes it can go for many, many years without causing any symptoms. And most of the treatments we have for this lymphoma, they don't necessarily cure the cancer. You know, it still is very treatable. We have lots of treatments that can reduce the levels of lymphoma or put it into a remission. But the cancer usually does tend to come back over time. So because our treatments are not necessarily curative, we really only need to employ them when we need to. And the main indication to need treatment is if a person does have symptoms or starting to have low blood counts or other complications related to the Waldenstrom's. The treatments that we have, you know, in general are getting better and better. Lots of treatments have fewer side effects compared to some of the older treatments that we use. But any treatment still does have the potential risk of side effects and requires more medical visits and so on. So if a person feels completely well and has no symptoms, starting them on treatment right now probably might impair their quality of life because they might get more side effects. We don't want the treatment to be worse than the disease. So that's why we tend to reserve treatment for those who need it if they have symptoms from the lymphoma.
Another question, if my main symptom is anemia and I'm treated for the anemia and go into remission, what is the likelihood of me developing other symptoms over time, or is it just anemia that I'm watching for?
You know, this is a lymphoma that can behave in different ways, and oftentimes it can be quite unpredictable. Low blood counts, like anemia, it probably is the most common complication of the lymphoma, though. So if that's a symptom that a person presented with, there is a high chance that that may happen again in the future. Other symptoms, though, can emerge over time, over the course of the disease. So that's why it's important to regularly check in with your doctor to measure your blood counts, other blood tests, and assess for any other symptoms as well.
If neuropathy is related to WM, is there a treatment to reduce the neuropathy?
So there are some treatments that can help with the discomfort associated with neuropathy. You know, some people can have kind of electrical tingling or some burning sensation from the nerve damage. So there are some medicines that help to sort of calm down that pain that can be associated with the neuropathy. But for the most part, if the neuropathy is being caused by the Waldenstrom's, we need to treat the underlying disease. So by giving treatment to get rid of the Waldenstrom's and bring it down to a low level, we can hopefully stop the antibodies from being produced that are attacking the nerve.
How important is it to have specific cryo testing if you have Raynaud's with WM?
Well, it depends on each situation. Cryoglobulinemia is not a very common complication of Waldenstrom's. But if a person has Waldenstrom's and they start to get new Raynaud's or other unusual rashes, that can be an indication of cryoglobulinemia. So it's important to do the test in that specific situation because that will help confirm that these symptoms are related to Waldenstrom's, in which case, you know, a person may be able to consider treating the Waldenstrom's to help improve those symptoms.
Is there anything a person can do to prolong the wait and watch stage? For example, nutrition, vitamins?
So there haven't been any particular, you know, dietary changes that have been proven to delay the time to treatment. You know, in general, I just advise my patients to live a healthy, active life. Important to, you know, drink plenty of water, eat a healthy, well-balanced diet. There's nothing particularly proven that you have to eat or avoid eating. That's important. It's just really doing those things that are good nourishment for your body to keep yourself in good, healthy shape so that when it is time for treatment years down the road, your body will be able to go through treatment as smoothly as possible.
Here's a lengthy question. When a pathologist is unable to distinguish between the diagnoses of LPL and SMZL, what clinical features would you consider in order to arrive at a definitive diagnosis?
That's a good question for a pathologist. It's actually a fairly common situation where we do a bone marrow biopsy, and you know, sometimes the results come back a little bit ambiguous. There are a number of different indolent lymphomas, and they can sometimes resemble each other. So in these cases, you know, we often review the biopsy with the pathologist. There are specific genetic tests that can be helpful in some cases. I mentioned the MYD88 mutation. It's commonly positive or detected in Waldenstrom's. It can be seen in other lymphomas as well, but not as commonly. Otherwise, we can look at other clinical features. So having the IgM protein may point us towards Waldenstrom's. You can sometimes see that in other lymphomas as well. Some of the other neuropathy or immune complications are probably more common with Waldenstrom's, so that can be a clue. But in general, you know, many of these indolent lymphomas, including Waldenstrom's and marginal lymphoma, they do tend to be treated quite similarly with a similar type of chemotherapy, for example. So if we can't arrive at a clear consensus as to exactly what subtype of lymphoma we're dealing with, we often do end up giving similar treatment in either situation.
Can WM cause skin problems, patches, or dry, scaly skin rashes?
Yeah, so Waldenstrom's, with its particular IgM antibody, it can affect all different kinds of organs in the body, including the skin. Sometimes there can be easy bruising from Waldenstrom's. Sometimes there can be purple or red rashes from the cryoglobulin protein or amyloid protein. Patches or dry, scaly skin, it's harder to say because lots of other conditions can also cause those. So it can be helpful to review any concerning rashes with your doctor or a dermatologist to try to tease out what the cause is.
What is it about aging that makes it a risk factor for WM?
So a lot of the lymphomas or blood cancers that we see tend to increase with older age. Each time, with every week and month that we age, as our cells grow and divide, these random mutations can occur in our lymph nodes that can turn our normal healthy lymph nodes into cancerous ones that can start to begin to grow out of control. So I think the aging process with the increase in cell turnover over time and the increased random mutations that can occur over time can all predispose to these blood cancers.
If a patient with WM is being treated for a yeast overgrowth, will the yeast overgrowth have any impact on the immunoglobulin staying low?
So usually the immunoglobulin levels in Waldenstrom's are low because the lymphoma may be taking over the bone marrow and making it hard for there to be enough normal healthy immune cells to produce the IgA or IgG or IgM proteins. The immunoglobulin levels can also be low because of certain chemotherapies or rituximab, which is the antibody that suppresses B cells. So usually the antibodies or levels are low because of the disease itself or because of the treatment for the disease. So they do tend to improve as we treat the Waldenstrom's or as a patient's immune system recovers from previous chemotherapy. In some cases, if the antibody levels remain low and a person is prone to recurrent or severe infections caused by low antibody levels, then we do sometimes in those cases consider intravenous immune globulin or IVIG. So that's a, kind of like a blood transfusion that contains antibody levels from healthy donors, and that can replenish the low antibody levels and help to reduce the risk of recurrent infections.
Getting back to, are there ways to prolong WM? If you are presently, wait and watch with WM. If you are presently in watch and wait and you observe a decreasing hemoglobin level, would it be advisable to consider boosting your iron intake, or is it an approach to be avoided?
It depends on each situation. So some people with Waldenstrom's can be prone to iron deficiency, especially if they have frequent bleeding or bruising. That can cause a person to lose a lot of iron over time. But some people with Waldenstrom's can actually have too much iron in the body, you know, especially if they've had a lot of blood transfusions in the past. And too much iron can actually be harmful to the organs. So if a person has low hemoglobin, we'll often check the iron levels as well as other blood tests to see if there is any other cause contributing to the anemia. And if there are low iron levels, then iron replacement can be helpful. But if the iron levels are normal or high, then in those situations, iron replacement usually isn't necessary.
Immunocompromised is a symptom of WM. I would like to know if there is an indicator in a blood test to indicate levels of immunocompromised.
So there are some tests that we can use to measure activity of our immune system. I mentioned the quantitative immune globulins, which measures our IgA, IgG, or IgM proteins. So if those are low, that can be an indication that a person may be at increased risk of infection. But truthfully, you know, the immune system is very complex, and we don't have great tests to measure every part of it. So probably the more important indicator is how frequently and how severe are the infections that a person may be getting. And that is probably the more telling sign of being immunocompromised.
Is it common for a WM patient to have extreme pain in their legs, feet, and groin?
So having pain in the legs and feet can be a symptom of neuropathy. Oftentimes it can cause numbness or tingling, usually starting in the toes, but it can increase higher up in the legs. Sometimes it can cause, you know, burning or electrical types of sensations if the nerves are being damaged from Waldenstrom's. So if a person is having unexplained pain, then it's important to assess for neuropathy. That's where we can refer them to a neurologist where they perform the specialized nerve conduction studies that can assess how well the nerves are working.
And one final question. How valid is the AWM patient risk calculator?
Yeah, it was developed in Boston, which is one of the world's biggest treatment centers for Waldenstrom's. And they did develop and validate it in a very large group of patients. And it is used throughout the world as well. The caveat to keep in mind, though, you know, it provides a general estimate of how long a person may expect to be able to go without requiring treatment. But every person and every lymphoma is different. So this may give you a sense of what to expect, but the most important thing will be to check in with your doctor and to see how your blood tests and how your symptoms are evolving over time.
Well, thank you, Dr. Puckrin, for a most thorough presentation and also for the answers to all of these questions, which you have not seen in advance. So very much appreciate your knowledge and your ability to communicate with us today. So we're now ready for